Thank you very much. Yeah, I don't speak Danish yet. I'm trying, but it's a difficult one, so will take a bit of time. So this presentation will be in English. I'm gonna start saying thank you to the people along this journey. I did my PhD in Spain with Fernando Albericio. I'm originally from Spain. And then I moved to Melbourne to do my first postdoc with the professor Frank Caruso. And after that, I did a second postdoc at Aarhus University, at iNano, with Professor Brigitte Stadler. My research background is in the interface of cell biology, chemistry, and material science. And it has always had as a goal the development of drug delivery vehicles. Now I just started, I'm starting my own group at DTU Nanotech, so also in Denmark, with Thomas Andresen as my mentor. And my research involves the development of nature-inspired drug delivery vehicles to treat certain diseases. This talk will have four parts. I'm gonna talk first about an introduction about artificial cells, then another second introduction to melanoma, then I will talk about the project itself, and finally, I'll draw some conclusions and future directions. So scientists have always been inspired by nature to solve complex problems. And the biomimicry field consists in borrowing nature design strategies to design new materials with better properties than the ones that are currently available. And since the cell is the basic structural unit of all living systems, a lot of effort has been put in mimicking not only its structure, but also its functionality. So the main feature of a biological cell is compartmentalization. So there is no life without compartmentalization, and cells have developed this strategy as a smart way to optimize the chemistry and the physics of using a single bilayer. They also use compartmentalization as a way to separate different cellular functions, which are mainly enzymatic reactions. And also, it serves to protect important contents from other degrading environments of the cell. In a compartment, the enzymatic reactions can take place without interfering with each other and without being degraded by other factors. What is an artificial cell is still being debated. So artificial cells are far less complex than real biological cells, but certain requirements need to be accomplished. For example, the subcompartmentalized structure is essential. It has to be a big carrier containing several compartments. And also, they have to mimic a specific aspect, mostly depending on the application in mind. They are expected to be a powerful therapeutic tool, with potential to substitute for missing or lost cellular function, usually in the context of an enzymatic defect. That is, if we have an illness that is caused by an enzyme that is not working properly, we can administer, for example, those artificial cells, and they will do the function. So it's a nature-inspired long-term solution for chronic diseases. In recent years, a lot of attention has been put into the development of these subcompartmentalized systems, which is nothing else than a big carrier containing several compartments inside. Some of the more important ones are liposomes, small liposomes inside a bigger one, or small polymersomes inside a bigger polymersome, small capsules inside a bigger capsule, or liposomes inside a polymeric capsule. I've worked a lot with liposomes inside capsules, which are, as the name says, the combination of liposomes inside a polymeric capsule. And because they are two different, very different components, they maximize the benefits of the two systems, the polymeric capsule and the liposome, and at the same time, they eliminate some of the drawbacks. What becomes more challenging? Well, so the liposomes in capsules, the two advantages is that, for example, a liposome is made of a phospholipid membrane, and it has the structure that resembles a cell membrane. On the other hand, the capsules, the polymeric capsule, is also artificially prepared, but is made of polymers instead of phospholipids, is larger than a liposome. While a liposome, we are talking about tens of nanometers, with the capsules, we are talking about micron-sized. So we can encapsulate many liposomes inside a polymeric capsule. What becomes more challenging is to mimic the functionality. We try to mimic enzymatic activities that can occur in our body. And to start with, as a proof of concept, we decided to encapsulate a model enzyme, which was beta-lactamase. We chose that one just because we can follow the reaction colorimetrically. I mean, we can follow by the eyes, just looking at it. Because the enzyme beta-lactamase is able to convert the substrate, yellow nitrosephine, into the product, which is the hydrolyzed nitrosephine, which is red. So we entrapped beta-lactamase inside the liposomes of the big capsule. And we used the temperature to increase the permeability of the liposomes. That way, the substrate could permeate through the membrane, interact with the enzyme, and be converted into the product. And we could monitor the reaction by absorbance reading, and also just by looking at it, since the control and the reaction at time zero were yellow, and then when time went by, as hours passed, the reaction tube became red, because we obtained the hydrolyzed product. So there's been a lot of effort in developing new compartmentalized systems, as the ones that I've mentioned before. However, there's very few of them with reported functional activity. And what is more critical is that they only cover proof of concept ideas. That is what I just explained. They usually encapsulate an enzyme and do a model enzymatic reaction in which a substrate gets converted into a product that is usually fluorescent or we can follow by absorbance. So none of them addresses a medically relevant issue with the idea to drive these compartmentalized systems a step closer to the clinic. So that's the idea of my project, to use these very sophisticated carriers or drug delivery systems for a real application, a really relevant one, such as the treatment of melanoma. So I guess you've all heard about melanoma. It's the fifth most common type of cancer, and it's also the most dangerous form of cancer. It only affects 2% of the skin cancer, but it causes the large majority of the deaths. And it's expected that the incidence of melanoma will double every 10 years in many countries. Only in the US, for 2015, 70,000 new diagnoses are expected, and 9,900 deaths are projected, like only in the US for 2015. So what is also like very worrying is that for melanoma, there are only adjuvant therapies available. So the three most important ones are immunotherapy, chemotherapy, and biochemotherapy. and they all have or limited response or palliative effect, but without survival benefit. So for melanoma, really, alternative solutions are highly sought after. If we study melanoma cells, they need a lot of the amino acid tyrosine for their metabolic cycle. And what is more, malignant melanomas, they need even higher concentrations of tyrosine to live and to carry on their metabolic cycle. So as an idea for to treat melanoma is to reduce the intake of tyrosine, because that way they cannot carry on with the metabolic cycle, and that will inhibit the growth of melanoma. However, that has really some adverse effects. It's not well tolerated in humans. You can't just stop taking in the amino acid tyrosine. So another idea that has been recently in the literature is that instead of reducing the amount of intake of tyrosine, we can use an enzyme, for example, tyrosinase, which converts tyrosine into L-DOPA. So therefore, the melanoma cells don't have enough tyrosine to carry on with the metabolic cycle. That will have some advantages because we reduce the amount of tyrosine by administering the enzyme into the melanoma. So it doesn't affect the intake of tyrosine. And that way, you will reduce the levels of tyrosine only locally in the cancer site. So it doesn't affect the rest of your body. However, there's a problem with the administration of enzymes. Administering an enzyme is very difficult. There's a lot of problems regarding enzyme bioavailability, toxicity regarding the enzyme, immune responses, because our body can recognize it as something foreign and will destroy it, and fast degradation of the enzyme by proteases or other components in the human body. Therefore, to administer an enzyme, we need a biomedical platform. And that's when I thought that artificial cells could be useful to be used for melanoma treatment. So the enzyme encapsulation in artificial cells would be a great opportunity, since the artificial cell, the liposomes in particular, will provide enzyme protection from other agents in the body, and also they will allow to perform the reaction for an extended period of time. That is, the substrate tyrosine could react with enzyme, be converted into L-DOPA, and do it like this again and again in a continuous manner, because the enzyme will be protected inside the liposomes. It wouldn't be degraded or damaged or denatured. Additionally, in literature, if we study melanoma cells, we can find that tyrosine kinase, the Merck receptor, it's involved in the oncogenesis of many cancers, and it's overexpressed in melanoma cells. So if we could target, if we could bind something to the Merck receptors, it would be a really good therapeutic target for melanoma, because inhibiting this receptor induces apoptosis, it induces the death of the melanoma cell. So recently, it has been reported that this compound, called UNC1062, binds with very high affinity to the Merck receptor, and then it blocks the tyrosine kinase cascade, and in turn, the melanoma cell dies. So this compound, the UNC1062, it's a very good anti-tumor compound against melanoma. So Another benefit of artificial cells or carriers containing several compartments is that you can encapsulate several drugs, several components in different compartments. So you can encapsulate the enzyme within one compartment and another small compound, such as UNC1062, in a different one. They don't interfere with each other, and you can control the ratio between those two compounds, for example, in just one big carrier. So without the activity of one compound interfering without the activity of the other one. So liposomes in capsules have several advantages because of the different nature of these two building blocks. On one hand, the polymeric capsule offers the structural integrity. The membrane is also semi-permeable, so it allows for the exchange of chemicals to be able to carry on enzymatic reactions. On the other hand, it protects the liposomes, because if we were just administering liposomes without being protected, they will be degraded very fast. However, we cannot use the polymeric capsule alone, because we cannot encapsulate fragile or small cargo. Small cargo, as the UNC1062 compound, will just leak out. And this is not, because it's very permeable, and this is not good enough to encapsulate an enzyme. You probably will affect the functionality, well, probably not for sure, you will affect the functionality of the enzyme. On the other hand, the liposomes provide the subcompartments so that you can control how many subcompartments to add and how many compounds in each one. And they are very useful, they are very suitable to encapsulate fragile biomolecules such as enzymes or small compounds, hydrophobic or hydrophilic, such as the UNC1062 compound. However, like liposomes by themselves, have a very low stability and are easily degraded. Therefore, the combination of liposomes inside polymeric capsules. Additionally, these compartments will be designed to be pH responsive, because in the tumor site, the pH is acidic. So the liposomes will be designed in a way that respond in different manners to the acidic environment in the tumor site. For example, the liposomes that contain the enzyme will be designed in a way that by decreasing the pH, the permeability of the liposomal membrane increases. It only increases. That way, the tyrosine would be able to cross the membrane, interact with the enzyme, and being degraded, being converted into L-DOPA. And it will do that in a continuous manner for an extended period of time, because the enzyme would be still protected. It won't be degraded. So this reaction could take place several times, again and again. However, the small compound UNC1062, which is the compound that has anti-tumor properties, will be encapsulated in a different type of liposomes. Those liposomes, when being exposed into the acidic pH, will completely disassemble, releasing the compound that will be able to kill the melanoma cells. So I expect that with this project, combining the two activities of the enzyme tyrosinase that reduces the amount of tyrosine, and by co-encapsulating a small anti-tumor compound in several separated compartments, we could obtain a synergistic effect of both lines of treatment. So, well, this project has been focused to the treatment of melanoma, but as you can maybe see, hopefully, it could be this sophisticated delivery vehicles can be used to treat a huge range of diseases, like almost like every type of disease in which you need combinatorial therapy. That is that you don't need only one medicine. You want to encapsulate several of them because it allows for combinatorial drug delivery using a single vector. So yeah, that was it. And well, I would like to thank L'Oréal and UNESCO for the prize that will allow me to carry on this project. And thank you to the Danish Royal Society of Science and Letters for the opportunity to give the talk today.